Good morning, everyone. Joining us today is Matt LaCortigia. He is currently an adaptive physical education teacher and department coordinator at the Perkins School for the Blind. Matt has a master's degree in education and degrees within the concentrations of physical education, athletic training, and health education. Matt is currently a certified strength and conditioning specialist by the National Strength and Conditioning Association and a certified inclusive fitness trainer by the American College of Sports Medicine. A resourceful, innovative teacher with 20 years professional experience in the field of APE as a teacher, coach, and trainer, Matt strives to provide safe and enriching movement, fitness, and athletic experiences to enhance the life of children and young adults who are blind, deafblind, or multi-impaired. Dedicated to leading and cooperatively working with colleagues to provide opportunities for students to access and participate in activities that promote health, wellness, and lifelong fitness. Matt was the recipient of the Amelia Rue APE Teacher of the Year Award and has served as Vice President of the APE Division for the Massachusetts Association for Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance. He has presented on topics related to adaptive physical education throughout New England and nationally. He is here today to enlighten us on the topic of adapting physical activities and games. Without further ado, it is with great pleasure that I introduce Matt LaCortigia.
First of all, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. And I'll just give you just a little bit more about myself and how I came into this profession. In undergraduate, I was a physical education and athletic training major. And so I didn't go through any formal training to be an adapted physical education teacher. So my perspectives is a little bit different. So I've kind of combined my experiences from health education, athletic training, strength and conditioning, and physical education. So I take a little bit what works from all those disciplines and my experiences, and that's where a lot of my kind of philosophies come from. So one of my goals today is to have at least everybody here remember at least 3 to 5 different things that I say, because I hope that maybe 4 or 5 years down the road, when you're working, you can remember back this 1 or 2 things that I mentioned that stuck with you from this little lecture today. So, and I'm gonna point out as I go through some things I think are real important. One of the things I'm gonna show you today is a tool that you can use in your clinic experiences, but beyond this, you can use it in different settings, and I think it's gonna be pretty practical for you. So if you have any questions, I'm open to any questions, and I'll try to leave time after, but during it, if you have a question, just raise your hand and we'll get to you. And I'm gonna leave time after too. So so let's get started. So what I'm gonna show you guys today is a planning model that you can use to either develop or adapt games, activities, or programs. And it can be used for people with disabilities or non-people or people without disabilities. My philosophy is I don't do anything different that I do with kids with disabilities than I do kids without. And we'll do the same. My same methods are the same. You know, might be doing it at different intensity levels and durations and endurance and stuff like that, but the methods are the same. So what I did, I used to always get, and I still get asked the question from different parents or other teachers, what can my son or daughter or my student do with the disability? You know, can't find any athletic or physical things for the student to do. And I could just throw out, oh yeah, there's beat baseball, there's, you know, swimming, and throw out a bunch of different activities and sports. But without me knowing the individual, how do I know that's gonna be the best for that child, for that student? So it got me thinking, there needs to be something that parents and teachers can go to identify and come up with different games and activities for their child or student. So I developed this planning model, because I said, look, all these other disciplines, health educators have all these different planning models. You know, athletic training has theirs. Strength and conditioning has the periodization. What does adaptive physical education have? Really nothing. So I developed this model, this planning model, that's called the FAIER Planning Model. And it's in this little booklet, which if you want, you can purchase it through the Perkins School for the Blind website. But I'm going through it today. So you don't really have to go to this. But that's where it's from, and the name of it's Run, Play, Move. So we can go to the next slide. Okay. So it can be used to develop physical activities, different lesson plans, different programs. If you want to start a program, we have, at Perkins, we have teachers or educators from across the country that come every year. There's a big group of them, about 15, usually from sometimes developing countries and so forth. And their schools aren't quite as advanced in teaching students with disabilities. And so they use this. I teach them this model to develop programs in addition to like lessons. And then this is a good thing to use to assist in including students in general PE or just inclusion in general. So here it is. And I try to do things and simplify them down. And the thing is, sometimes simplicity builds complexity. So this is the model here, and it may seem pretty simple, and it's because I try to simplify it. But you take each phase, and you can really dig deep into it, and it can be more complex. So first thing, the first phase I call foundation, because you need a good foundation to really to build on. These are the most important aspects. And that's one, goals. And what I mean by goals, I don't mean SMART goals and, you know, like you do your objectives too when you have behavior or criteria and condition and all that stuff. That is simply, what is the purpose for the activity that you're doing? What is the benefit for the student or students in that activity? Okay, that will help answer any questions that come up when you design the activity. So if I come in, you're teaching a class, I will never come in and just start critiquing, criticizing you for what you're doing without knowing what your goal is of the class or that activity or lesson. That'll help drive how you set things up and what you do. So you have to have it, and it could just be simple. Something like, okay, the goal for these activities is just for everybody social, more of a social goal, okay? And we're always going for increased independence, but sometimes it's more than that. All right, second big thing, strengths and capabilities, and in this phase, what can the student do? Anything. 5 degrees extension in the right leg, that's something the student can do. I can use that, okay? Anything that the student can do and do well, that's more of a strength. Both of them. I want to know what the student can do. This is where you start. You get a new student that comes to you, start there. What can the student do? Okay. Then the next thing, what does the student like? That's the second thing you should ask. Okay. And it just doesn't mean, you know, and it can be small things as like colors, or the student likes to move, likes to sit, likes a certain toy, likes certain objects. All those little things are important to know because you can incorporate them into the activity or use them as a reinforcer after. But you got to build, you got to start somewhere. Okay? And then resources. And I like to call this available resources. So what you have available to use right now in your environment. So there's available resources and then there's a larger resource. You know, and that's really resources, anything you can use, utilize in your activity or to develop an activity or lesson. So in other words, I could come in this room here and have the students come in the clinic and design activities just using the stuff in this room. So we have a table, we have some space here, and I have all of you as a resource. That's kind of the idea. And I'm going to show you videos. I have videos and pictures that's going to give you examples of all of these. So that's the key phase, phase one. Phase two, awareness. And I call it awareness because it's things you need to be aware of but not focus on. It's the, kind of the secondary. It's not that they're not important. They are important, but the foundation is really the key. That's where you're going to get it. But you do need both of them. So under awareness, you have accommodation, specially designed instructions, and medical clearances or medical awareness. Medical awareness. So accommodations is usually in the terms of physical aids, or it's not actually always physical, I shouldn't really say that, but more like, could be like glasses, hearing aid, a walker, wheelchair, things of that nature. The specially designed instruction is, that's where you start getting into things like communication, sign language, maybe using Mayor Johnson pitches. And there's a lot of specially designed instruction. That's really where the modifications come in. So using a smaller environment, less distractive environment, using lighter equipment, those type of things. And it usually is going to relate to the student's disability. So, and I'll show you some of those things. So the first two phases, and then the medical awareness, things that you need to be aware of. Does a student have any allergies? Does a student have seizures? Do they have any medical conditions that you need to know? Are there any activities that are contraindicated? You know, meaning that the student shouldn't participate in that particular activity. So the phase one and two is your gathering information phases, okay? And this is something you can do real quick in your head. This is what I do, this is what goes on in my head, and I just put it on paper. So that you do before you kind of design the lesson or activity, and then you implement it, and you build your activity. You have all the information right there to create your lesson or activity. And then go over to, and this actually starts phase four, evaluating, starts right when the class starts, or the activity starts, and you design the, and as you're designing it, and then once the activity starts. You should be looking for, this is one of the things I want you to remember, three things when you're working with the kids today. I want you to look for these three things. Is the activity safe? Okay, does it look safe? Is it something that should be doing? Is there any hazards in the area? Are the students completing the task? And their response. Okay, because that's going to tell you a lot, those three things. If they're completing the task, are they completing it too easy or is it too different? That's where the challenge is. Too easy, they're going to be bored. Too challenging, they're going to be frustrated. Okay, so see the level of it. You know, are they completing it? And are they doing it easily or is it too difficult? And then, are they enjoying it? Are they liking it? And you're going to see in some of the videos. Then the last part is basically adding on adding different components. You want to emphasize balance, or you want to emphasize some math concepts or other subject concepts. And this is where you also, based on your evaluation, the task completion is really too easy. The student's really doing this. We got to make it a little more challenging so we can progress. So this is it in the nutshell. So, all right, just a couple of things. This is not a curriculum, it's a process. It's a thought process. It's a thought process to create, to help you be more creative. Your greatest resource is your mind. You know, it really is. And it's designed to organize information to create a thoughtful process of coming up with activities. Can be used in multiple settings, multiple disciplines. Is only one aspect of adapted physical education. And just one, and then the most important, it's centered on the individual. So it's always looking, if you look at that, the model, it's looking at the individual or groups of individuals. You can do it as a group too, okay, a class as a whole. So it's all about the student. What's the student's strengths? What's their preferences? You know, so, all right, let's get to the good stuff. So in this particular video, what you're going to see here is that's a black and yellow ramp that's made out of like cardboard. I don't know what you call that, hard cardboard, but that's what it is. And it's very simple. We're fortunate at Perkins to have adaptive tech center where we can come up with some designs, and they can kind of make them on the cheap in there. So I had them come with this ramp that I use a lot. It's lightweight, it's flexible, so I can move it up and down and all over on a student's lap and so forth. So that's using available resource. Black and yellow painted. That's the contrast that we need for students who have cortical visual impairment. Yellow and black are the good colors that you need. Okay, so that's going to specially designed instruction from the student. So that's why it's there. We have it painted that color. Orange ball. Now, I'm assessing this now too. Maybe I should have a yellow ball there, might be better. A yellow colored ball might even be best in this, more of a contrast. So this particular student has cortical vision impairment. So what the ball is sitting on is what I call a ball launcher. And this is something that I had come up with in our assistive tech department made it for us. So you plug it in. And it, when you hit this, and then there's a switch that the staff person assistant is holding that's connected to the ball launcher. Now, what you don't see in this video, and you'll hear it when it plays, is on the other end, there's another student. So this is a bowling activity. So one student is doing the bowling part. The other student is actually setting up the pins. So if we can go ahead and play it. That's the student setting up the pins on the other end. So she's doing a good job of being patient and giving her the opportunity. Process, allowing for time to process, is another specially designed instruction. So he's switching, that student there is switching the pin from one hand to the other and setting it up on the mats. So what am I using here? It's some more available resources, mats. to raise it up. Okay, we can go to the next one. Oh, is that the same one? Okay, so this, I'm using the same equipment and it's the same students and it's a basketball activity, adaptive basketball activity. So, and we can play this video. This is just showing you the setup of it, the design. So, it's a...
We're not pushing it off.
I'll let it play first. So, the student that has the yellow ball now is placing the ball up on there. And then if we play the next video, okay, so what I've done here is in the basket, I could have put a basketball hoop there, but I'm like, we're going for independence here, going to the goal of the activity. And what she likes loud noises. So what I put in the basket was a switch that when it's activated, go, a basket comes on, which is motivating, she likes it. So I'm using preferences there. So that's getting her motivated to use her capability of her head and neck motion. And then I'm using the rest of the stuff, the ramp and stuff like that, all those resources I have available. So now I'm assessing this. It looks pretty safe to me. Maybe if this wasn't all the way on or something, it could come down. But for the most part, it's pretty safe. She completed the task. Wasn't too easy, it was, and she seemed to like it. So this is a good activity. Now, I could, if my goal, say I had more kids in the class or something, was doing basketball, I might not use this whole ramp and everything set up. If it was more of like a social game, we're doing like wheelchair, you know, a lot of students in wheelchairs and stuff, then I might give her some more physical assistance or to, you know, like pass a ball or something like that. But this is in a small class setting. We're working really on specific things. So it goes to the goal of the activity. Okay, we can go. All right, so this activity here, this is a good one. Because what you're gonna see is, and this is probably like the one of the early lessons in this unit. It's a modified basketball. And it's got three or four students in the class. And the student that, is to my right, that's kind of running here with the blue shirt on. He has very good motor skills. He has, you know, his vision, his limited vision and hearing, uses a hearing aid, but his motor-wise, motorically, he can do a lot. He can run and jump in different planes and directions and stuff when you have him do certain movements, he has difficulty, but functionally, he is much more advanced motor-wise than the other students in the class. And this is a good example of how you combine students of different abilities, sometimes large different abilities, into one activity. So what we have set up is a, well, let's go ahead and play it. And
Thank you.
Okay, so in this activity, there's a lot going on. So what I have, and this was, what I did is you see the students against the wall. I have them, so it's a relay, and I timed it. They have like 2 minutes. And the student that has more of the motor skills, I make it more challenging for him. So I have him do a beer walk from the cone to the hoop. And then he's got to shoot it, and you can't really see, but there's a, you know, one of the little kid hoops you put on your door. It's a closet door we have. So, you know, a cheap thing you buy at, Target or something. So we have that on the door there that he's shooting into. And the ball he's using actually is from like a Target 2. You know, like a small, you know, like $4 ball that's in the big bins. Works out very nicely there. And then pretty good color contrast too. But anyway, so he has to go and shoot. There's a poly spot that he's got to shoot from. And the other students are actually bringing cones in this. But what I did is when I was evaluating it, I said, wait a second. Why are they using cones there? They should use a basketball too, because it is a basketball. So I set it up with the basketballs that they put there, and they have to move it down and then shoot it into a hoop at that height, and they're actually just throwing it. Each team has to count how many they get in. So in this, the student doing the beer walk, we added some math in there. By twos, 2 points each. So, and he's got to figure out his score after. And the other students would count the cones that they're using. And we'd go sit on the bench and see who won that round. And then we come back and do it again. But what I'm doing is I'm utilizing all of their capabilities. Some are different. These guys are just walking. He can do more, so I'm having him run and do the bear walk, doing the same activity. That progression, we're adding in different component, a little bit of math. So you can really switch this up. There's no really right and wrong. There's no, it's what you come up with and you evaluate it and you move on. Is it safe? Are they completing it? Are they liking it? And then using that, you can, in this activity here, this is a resource you can build off of this. So what happens is you look and you say, oh wow, the student's really liking this. Now I can do this other activity or build off it. So, okay, let's go to the next one. Yeah. These are some slightly older students. And this gym that they're in, I don't know if you can tell, it's not very big. Okay, so I have to be a little creative when you have some older or bigger students in this gym. We do have a big gym on campus, but this is the one in this particular school building. So sometimes with crunches for classes, you can't get over to the big building. So we end up having some of the older or bigger students in this gym. So it was very simply set up like a 5-10-5 shuttle run. We're using bean bags. I think there's three students in this class. I don't know if all three were here at that time, but we can go ahead and play it.
That's it, running out these last ones.
And you can keep an eye on the student in the white. I'll comment on him. Okay, so what this was is I had the 3x3 shuttle, but three bean bags lined up in a row, and then another few feet away, another three, then another three. They just got to go get one, come back. Second row, third row. So there's a sequence to it. The two students to the near, they're pretty, you know, they pick it up pretty quick. So the student in the white, excuse me, you know, had some difficulty doing it, and confused, you know, a little bit. Didn't quite figure out the expectations. So we have assistant doing it with him, one, but we also have those numbers. Those are numbered bases that are there, that I have 1, 2, 3, so just to help get the order. First this one, and then the second one, and then the third. This student in the white, by the way, after doing it, this is the other thing. You need lots of repetition and consistency. Consistency and repetition are key. That's kind of like your specially designed instruction in kind of that area. But he's able to do it now by himself. And he doesn't really run it, he more walks it fast, but he has the sequence and can do it. Excuse me. All right, and we can do the next one. I think it's maybe the same. What I do is I time them on how long it takes them to do it and try to challenge them to beat their time. Eventually, we took away the numbered bases.
Yes, good job!
So it's just one little activity that they can do in this small space where they're moving. So the goal is kind of continuous movement here. I've also done in this little gym setup like a figure eight.
Ooh, Michael, last one.
Walking pattern with cones. So they walk around in a figure eight pattern. It's hard to do some as like a warm up. Can't really, in this size gym, you can't really do some warm up laps. So they're completing it. Maybe it was, could be more challenging. The student, you know, nearest us, probably his reaction was, doing it. But sometimes you're going to get that. You have to do work. So, all right, we can do the next. All right, so this is a recent, actually, it was just taken last week at a local YMCA that we go to. And I think, at least in the education setting, I think it's really important to get students out into the community. And I kind of wonder sometimes how much that is done. But we've been running this a community fitness program for over 10 years. So this is the first time. Usually we're up in the fitness room, but here we're in the functional trainer room. And you'll see that they have schedules very similar to this. And most of these students, all of these students, do very well with the pitchers. It helps keep them on task and help understand the expectations. So we're going to do this and then go on to the next one. We're going to do this so many times. That is that specially designed instruction accommodations. Okay? So now, if you don't, say you didn't have this. Okay? Now, say this one of the students was having a real tough time. And he's spinning around and he keeps going over to the stability balls and just didn't have a very successful time. And so now you're assessing it. Well, the area you kind of need to go to look at is that awareness. That's when you really kind of look at that awareness phase and say, am I using all the specially designed instructions? Is there any other instruction or modifications I could use to help that student? Can anybody tell me the four functions of behavior? Anybody know that here? So the four reasons why we do anything we do. So this is something you can remember and think of with your students today. You're going to either do something to access something, to get something. You want something. I want that music. I'm going to scream. So you give me that music. So to access something, for attention, seek attention. You want me to come? I want you to come over here, so I'm going to start hitting my head. To escape from something. I don't want to do it. I don't want to participate in PE class. So I'm going to act out. Okay, go to the office. I got what I wanted. I didn't want to do those push-ups. So, and then the fourth one is a sensory need for sensory reasons internally. So we see that a lot with, you know, kind of like toe tapping or sometimes kids who rock back and forth. That they need some that sensory input. Sometimes we have students that in swimming, because I know you guys do swimming here, that like to go submerge under the water and like not want to come back up. Anybody have a student do that? No? And I'm not 100% sure of it, but I think they like the sensory feel of the pressure on there, so I think they're doing that for sensory. Keep those things in mind, because that's where, if you're having difficulty, students kind of behaviorally and stuff, look at that. Try to ask yourself, why is the student doing it? It's going to be one of those four areas. And if you can figure out, and sometimes they're combined, then that can help in addressing that. So, all right, let's play this clip. Oh, sorry. That's not on video. That's a picture. Okay, you can go to the next one. All right, so these are the photos now. Okay, thank you. So this one, another recent picture, but we've used this, I've used this setup quite a few times. So in this class, we have students that are all in wheelchairs. You know, have pretty limited range of motion. So what I've done is we just set up this mat table game. And basically, I'm just using available resources that I have. And I think there's some wedge mats that are under the big mat that I spread out. And I have some cones propped on each corner. And then we use these big stability balls. And it's soft and it sets up at the height so we can get their arms up on the table. And it's simply pushing the ball, rolling it across. And we make a game out of it. So we give points that, you know, if it goes off the other team's edge, you know, it's like a goal. And we kind of go back and forth. So it's a nice, so this is, yeah, it's a little bit social, but I want them to be kind of actively moving as much as they can, is the goal for this. And to have some fun doing it, you know. So one of the other games I've done with this group, and I've done it, works good too with students who are in wheelchairs and students who are ambulatory also. I do this kind of makeshift capture the flag game. I call it like capture the treasure. And where I have cones set up, the large orange cones set up all over the gym, and I put small little plastic balls on them, ones that have good color contrast with the orange, usually yellow. And we break into two teams, and one team has a bunch of light balls, you know, kind of like playground size balls. And what they have to do, it's almost kind of like a dodgeball type thing. They have to throw the ball or touch the ball to one of the students, usually who are like in a wheelchair or who are ambulatory, before they take all the balls off the cones. So they got to get all the balls off the cones, and then they win the treasure. Usually I put some music or something motivating at the other end of the gym. So, and it's good because the kids got to walk around, they got to move around, they got to kind of dodge and so forth. So that's, but that is, you know, so there I'm going for a little bit different goal. So we can go to the next one. All right, so this one here is we're just practicing the skill of striking a ball off a cone. You'll see as we have the good contrast with the yellow on the orange, you know, which goes right back to that specially designed instruction type phase. The other thing is I've done is have the students, so the bin of balls is kind of right over there. Usually I have it a little closer so the students got to go grab the ball off, put it on, and then strike it. And a lot of times I'll have another student at the other end retrieving it. So we're working on a lot of, you know, they got to bend down to get it, you know, so you're using the your hips and ankles and knees. And then this, they're getting good repetition. So, okay. And this was the student who was in one of the earlier videos. And he's just working on one of his objectives of transferring objects from one hand to the other and working on grip strength. Also focus in, on the task. So this one they're doing a similar striking. We have baseball, but in this you'll notice what's good is that we have it. I have it set up so that they're all doing it at one time. So there's no turn taking here. So you want that, you know, high activity time. Not to say that turn taking is not a good thing, because it is. Students need to work on the turn taking. But my goal for this particular lesson was I want them all moving and I want them all doing something. See? So now if I had one student that was, you know, wandering off or not hitting it or walking in front of the other one and darting away or whatever, maybe I'll go to a turn taking or a station type activity. So that's where the goal of the activity can kind of alter your setup. One of the other things that, you know, I said, you know, I think it's important to get the students out into the community. So what we do at Perkins is we have a after school recreation program also. So we offer a lot of kind of those lifetime physical activity, recreational activities. So some of these photos are these. So this is at a driving range. And what we do during the physical education classes during the day, we really work because we're working on specific IEP goals and objectives related to the student. But we're also working broader too. So we're working kind of fine-tuning, increasing range of motion and strength and acquiring different sports skills and stuff, but so that they can actively participate in some of these lifetime recreation skills. So this is at a local golf course driving range. We did one class was an access to community rec class that we did during our regular physical education class, and we went into different units off in the community and on campus. Some came to us. So we can go to the next one. So this is like almost, I talked about progression before. So this is just I think it's called Snagit or something, one of those young kids starter sets. So here I'm using some physical guidance to help the student strike the ball. And then this is a modified tennis that we do. That ball has some bells in it. That's tennis serves. I don't know if anybody's heard that, is an organization started up to teach tennis, a modified version of tennis to individuals who are blind or visually impaired. That's one of the balls that's used. And it's kind of almost like a badminton type racket in a smaller net, and it's played indoors on a basketball court that is partially tactile lined. This is an example of specially designed instruction. I did a class last year, a health and wellness class with a group of students. We spent the whole year on it. So this was one of the early things that we did. We're differentiating physical activity and exercise. So we did a relay on it, and the kids would have to bring the pitches and put them under the right category. This was just taken the other day. So it looks kind of like a mess here, but I thought I'd throw it in because it gives a good example of using some resources and so forth. So we have some, the outdoor green carpet, you know, like that turfy stuff. So we had four pieces of that. We just trialed this out. So what we're going to do is we're going to actually tape it together with some wrestling mat tape. So it's all one. And we're going to put some white tape on it, lines, so we have a football field. So we're doing a unit on football. We're going to get to like flag football. So we do it on this surface. So we thought, let's make it, you know, kind of like a little bit of a more feel for football. And then we just use the, those are like the cardboard rolls that had, that the thing was rolled up in, and we made it like a goalpost out of it. So we're going to tape that and paint that up. So we'll have that. And the kids had a great time doing it. So, but it's an example of using what's available to you, what you have around you. Not worrying so much about the things that you don't have or things that you want. I mean, those are important too, that you get the things that you might need. I think that's it. And this is just a picture of one of the tandem bikes. Is another lifetime physical rec activity that we can, that they can do. All right, so this student here, this is modified disc golf that we do a lot in the spring. So as a student, what I'm trying to do here is, so I'm giving him, making this more challenging rather than just giving him the disc and putting it through the hoop. He's got to select which is the right object out of those three that goes through the hoop. So now I'm kind of really focusing in on specific type skills. So this is kind of a different goal here rather than just going out and playing. So you can do the next picture, I think. Yeah, he got the right one that time. Now, maybe. You need repetition. That just doesn't mean he could have got lucky on that one. He actually did. This is a particular student, another example of just trying to work off what the student's capabilities are and what you have available to you. So the student is actually on a treadmill that's shut off and unplugged on a folded up mat. And you'll see there's a body bar that I have going through the handles of the treadmill that the student, if we continued on, which we don't, that's all right, it would reach up and grab and hold that bar. So he's getting a good stretch here. And at the same time, we're working his legs. So we have that BOSU ball, the blue one, that his feet are pushing into and giving him some feedback. So he's really working on like a full type body, almost exercise. And we count how long he'll hold on. We also do the, with some of our more capable students, and we have Olympic bar in a cage, and I'll put that across the safety bars, and they'll do similar to that and do the pull-ups, the reverse pull-ups. So this is just a real modified version of that. So it's looking at, oh, this exercise here, and it's all the way broken down to someone who's usually in a wheelchair is doing kind of a version of it. Another student using the ramp, and you can move on. Okay, yeah. So that student, that last student there, she really likes that ramp and the hitting of the ball and stuff. So we used that. We said, well, she's working on improving her range of motion in one of her arms. So let's put that switch on a wall up high. So now she's got to reach up high and hit the switch because she really likes that. So it's another example of using a preference in the activity. So are there any questions?
Wow. Yes.
So you know how you had the cone and you said your goal was to have them all move?
Yeah.
Like hitting it with the...
Yeah.
Okay. What are some other things that could be useful? Is that hand-eye coordination or like visual?
Yeah. All, those two things, plus even for some of them, the, you know, gripping the racket, or the bat. So with them, like a lot of our students in that class, they can do it in one hand and go like this and hit it off. No. So then two hands, get the bat up, let's get a good swing. Okay. See, sometimes the kids will take the easy way. Oh, I know this expectation. This is easy. Okay, well, now we're asking more of you. I know you can hit it with the one hand. Have to do it with the two. So that's an example of me assessing the activity. Yeah, the student's completing the task, but it's easy. The reaction, I'm not really getting any reaction out of the student that doesn't, you know. So I gotta challenge the student a little bit more. So, and they might not like it at first. It's a progression, it's like a step. You go up. And it's just, hey, it's the same for all of us here. It's like when you start something new that you haven't done before, you know, usually it can be frustrating. You're not that good at it. I remember the first time I skied, I'm falling down all the time. You know, what fun is that? So you gotta make little baby steps. You know, create an environment that you have some success, and then you come back to it. Because everybody likes to be successful. So you're really kind of creating the environment that the student can have some success and will come back to it. And then you make it, you ease in some more challenges, make it more difficult. Any other questions?
Can you isolate like this type of program to like just improving one side? Like,
yeah.
If a kid is having an issue, just throw them with the left, but they're good with the right. Like, how do you accommodate for that?
So if you want to, like, if, let me see if I understand the question. So if someone's kind of more left-hand dominant and you want them to use more the opposite hand,
yeah.
the right hand, mm-hmm. yeah. And that particular student, the one with the student that was doing the bowling pins, transferring them over, that's that student right there. Likes to, the one side will do a lot. Can use the other side, but not prefers the other one. So I'll design the activity that the student has to use that hand. So we're doing a unit, and he's in it, and it's, we got five different students. Four students in wheelchairs, one student who's ambulatory. So we set up like this little relay game. Two students that are evenly matched motor-wise are on each side. So they're going against each other. The student who's ambulatory has got to bring all the balls and equipment down to him. So he's working on the moving. And then, so the first thing is very simple. I have them, there's a cone between the two. Student comes, puts the ball on it. First one to grab it gets a point there. I'm setting him up so that he can't use his dominant hand. So you create the environment. Now what's the student gonna do? What do you think he does? Goes like that. So, you know, I make it so, and then I tell him, no, you need to use your right, this arm. And then, and he'll do it. So you can manipulate the environment to what your goal is that you want to do. You know, just no different than you do with any other athlete. You know, like you're doing training, you want to, you know, improve speed or something. You know, you're gonna gear it more towards that. Make the athlete do that. So, good question.
This model is so great because it can be applied to basically any situation or any scenario. Do you have any like recommendations or anything? Because this is an 8-week program for an hour and a half each Saturday, so one day a week for 8 weeks. Do you have any recommendations, like if you're ever like, not that we're pressed for time or anything, but in a shorter span, shorter time span, do you approach things differently, or do you always look at it the same, knowing that you have maybe have like a year to work with somebody as opposed to like a few weeks, or are there any differences that you might take?
Yeah, I don't, for all my students, because I get to know them and so forth, you know, they'll have long-term goals. Or, I don't want to say long-term goals, but my envisions of them long term. And everything that I do within one activity or lesson is done for a reason. So you can come to any one of my classes and say, oh, what are you doing that for? And I'll give you an answer. And it should be leading to something else. So you can ask me, well, what's the next step? What's the next progression? And I should be able to tell you that. Now, when I get new students
or, you know, and I don't even know much about them, I'm going right to this first phase of the model. What are they, what can they do? What are they like? So immediately, I go in right to that, right looking at the individual and saying, what can I utilize with this student or group of students? And then it's, and sometimes, hey, you just, I kind of call it, it's almost a glorified trial and error. It's trial and error with reason. You have reasons why you're doing it. You're not just throwing stuff up against the wall. But a lot of it is. And so for you guys, not knowing maybe the students and stuff, you're going to just have to kind of try things. But try them based on things, information you get from the student. You know, so kind of look at the student and say, well, the student is moving his arm a little bit or likes this or that.
So if you're working with someone who's nonverbal, do you have any suggestions for finding out what they like? If they're nonverbal.
Yeah, so, and that's a good question. And I, just seeing their body language and their movement. So you're gonna really basically read their kind of body language. So you'll tell, you can pretty much tell if they're not gonna like something or like something, they might be resistant, pull away. If they want something, they wanna access something, they might be trying to grab you or pull you or go to something. So it's difficult. What I would say though is one of my first questions with that student, what is that student's communication method or mode? Well, likely, you know, if they're going to school, they might have some sort of communication system. So that would be, I don't know if the students come with any that you guys have here in the clinic, if they have like say a communication book or any symbols. A lot of our students who are deaf-blind, I ask how do they communicate? Well, there's a couple of different ways. So, but one on a more basic level, students will use objects. Objects represent different things or activities. So maybe it's a small cup for drink or something like that. You know, maybe it's a little piece of a ball for gym class. So, but not knowing the student and not coming with anything, you really gotta observe, read their body language, facial expressions. You know, if you reach out to shake their hand or something, you touch their hand and they kind of pull away, that'd be a sign they don't really like tactile or they don't like the touch. You know, it depends, you know. So that's where, you know, it would be kind of difficult. But you have to just try to read them if you don't get any information. But the best scenario is you gain some information. Talk to the parent. You talk to somebody, your, you know, supervisor. Oh, did you get any information on the student, how the student communicates, what student likes, what student can do? More questions?
Okay, that was
good. Okay. So, I don't have any handouts, but I can pass out the cards that have my email and phone number on it. So feel free to contact me and a couple other resources. I do have, if you go to on the Perkins School for the Blind website, you'll see under, if you go under some resources, I do have some lesson plans of different activities that you can go in and access. So,
we, on behalf of the CPDC, we want to thank you very much. And this is a T-shirt for
you. Oh, thank you.
And we'll handle that at the end.
Okay. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure having you.